Hi, I'm Joey Trombley, and welcome to an edition of Hometown Stories. Our travels have taken us on Route 9 in Chazy. We're at the Town Historian Office, and on the camera is the founding father himself, Calvin Castine. And I'm already going to go start off by calling this is going to be a Hometown Story Classic. We're with three graduates of Chazy Central Rural School, and this is a big year in Chazy, as Chazy Central Rural School is celebrating the 100-year anniversary of the consolidation of all the schools, and it was the first centralized school, definitely in New York State. We take claim in the country. There's a little debate on that. But the first centralized school in the area by William H. Minor and Reverend Mott. And we have with us Mr. Richard West, and you were the class of?
54.
54. And Mr. John West, class of?
1940.
And Bob Cheeseman, our town historian.
Class of 1954.
So 1954. So with that being said, all of you went through the old school from K through 12?
Well, there was no K at that time, but okay. I came in second grade.
Second grade?
First grade, Miss Robinson was the teacher.
First grade, Miss Robinson was also my first grade teacher.
Wow, okay.
And Uncle John and I, at one time or other, were both put behind the sandbox in Miss Robinson's spot. Not together, but...
Was that like getting a ghost star today?
Well, the stars were very small. But that was the height of punishment in first grade.
It's kind of cute. So, talking about the school, and I'll go from left to right here, Mr. West, what was the first thing you think of, one of your fondest memories of that school?
Oh, geez, fondest. I think probably the one, you know, is starting right back in first grade, because that, you know, was a great experience, coming into school and being with other people. It was very nice. I remember that very well.
Do you remember how big your class was?
I think there were about 25 students, and there were two first grades, and there were two seconds, and I think two thirds. After that, it went to, you know, to one grade each, but there were two first grades. Miss Wing was the other first grade teacher at that time.
Okay, and I gotta go Uncle Richard and Uncle John. Okay. That's just the way it is. So Uncle John, what's one of your fondest memories?
I think graduating, making it through.
Okay. Yeah. And was it a hard experience going through that school, or was it a fun experience?
We had fun. We had fun.
How big was your graduating class?
I think 19. This just happens to be the picture of it.
Y'all could pick it up here.
Bob brought it out before he came. I think it was 19 in there.
Okay.
I remember.
All right.
And of that group, there are three was living yet.
Okay.
Yeah.
And who are the other two?
What's that?
Who are the other two?
Jim Gagne, who's in Michigan, and Leela Peltier, I think she's in Ogdensburg.
Okay.
Yeah.
All right, and have you stayed in touch over the years?
Constantly, yes.
That's really cool.
Yeah, we do.
That's very nice. And Bob?
Well, I'll have to say, like John, the pleasure and relief of making it all the way through, and then after we got out of school and got some age on us, our class has stayed very close, I would say. And that gives a lot of pleasure in just knowing that you've got people around you've known for so many years.
Well, there's a lot of pride in this school, as we all know. And I think, Uncle Richard, you started the Alumni Association many years ago.
Yes, I did. The thought occurred in 1979. We had our first get-together in 1980. And the idea came about again, back in my mother's kitchen. My aunt that graduated from Moore's was there, and she said she had to hurry because she had to go get ready for her alumni banquet. And it had been in the back of my mind for a long time. So I went to my uncle, Bill Wood, and he was a graduate in 1934 from Chazy. Well, he took the bull by the horns, and like I say, 1980 was our first get-together, and every year we have a banquet that we try to celebrate or honor the 50-year class. And when we first started, we had as high as 165 come to our banquets.
When it was new?
When it was first started, 165 and 150 was common. But as we get farther away from the ones that attended and graduated from the old original school, we have fewer people come. But there's still enough to make it worthwhile doing.
Because you need more of the younger graduates to get involved now.
We certainly do. The invitation is open. We would like to have more people involved in our committee, but that seems to be hard to come by, too. It's always left up to two or three people to head the whole thing anyway. But it's still going, and we intend to keep it going. We have been very fortunate that we can offer scholarships now, and we have given a goodly amount through the years, and it's worked out well.
And graduation weekend is an event in Chazy. I think there, it starts with a T. Is there a
letter? It starts with the T at the Minor Museum. They've always been gracious enough to allow us to have our little celebration there, which we call a tea. It's a little bit of punch and cookies and stuff. But yes, every year since 1980, we've had our tea. It's on Friday afternoon, normally like from 2 to 4. So people that are going to attend graduation, they have plenty of time to.
Now, it's my understanding that the senior class shows up there for the tea?
The senior class is invited every year. And we get a pretty good turnout of the seniors to come over. And if they normally come as a group, which gives them a little more confidence with a sure. bunch of older people. But it does give them a chance to meet, you know, some of us that have been out 50, 60, 65, 70 years plus.
Right.
You know, it's interesting. There used to be larger families to begin with. And there were a couple of families, it seemed like it was a competition. The Trombley family, that's the family from up in Ingraham, and the West family. They all had maybe 9 or 10 siblings that graduated from Chazy. And they always used to try to encourage the rest of the family to come. So it was not unusual to have 8 or 9 from each family coming to the tea. And coming to our banquets too, it was nice.
And I know Uncle Johnny, you frequent them every year. I see you at the banquet.
I try to. Yes, I do.
So you've been going for years, and Bob, yourself also.
I started a few years ago, and I kept it up pretty well. Although this year I wasn't able to attend.
I've got a question here to West here. You started in 1980. Have you noticed that the 50-year graduates have gotten younger and younger over the years?
You know, that's something, yeah. There's not that many gray-haired ones in there as there are in the used to be. But the 50-year class, yes, they are getting younger. And it's amazing because some of them, I can remember as, you know, youngsters. You know, when you've been out 60-plus years, it's everybody looks younger to you.
They're still kindergartners.
They're still kindergartners.
Or first graders to you.
They're still young. Just think how they must look to Uncle John.
Yeah. You know? I know we're going to get to a lot of neat pictures and stuff, and I'm going to throw this question out here because the school was torn down, the old school, a new school was put up, and that was very controversial at the time. At least I'm being told that it was, and you can answer the question or not, but what were your thoughts when this was going on, and do you think it was a good idea, or there's regrets that it had taken place?
Well, I'm sure there's regrets by the age group that did graduate from there, that went through the 12 or 13 years there. Sure, there's a lot of regrets, and you kind of wonder, it could have gone the other way, for the amount of money. It's just, as we were told at that time, the Minor Foundation and the state and the federal government would not give any money to remodeling the old school, or bringing it up to code, as they call it. And with the new school, there were all kinds of state and federal and minor money for the new school. So
that was the decision that was made.
That was what was made, and the group of people that were really making the decision were of an era where the minor supported the school almost 100%, so school taxes were hardly anything. Well, by going with this new one, there's more responsibility for the taxpayers, and there was quite an increase from the old school to the new one in taxes. And a lot of people, I'm sure that generation before me, took that into consideration, because they didn't really know what school taxes were, mm-hmm. to amount to anything. And it was going to be an increase, so that's the way it went.
And you, Uncle Johnny?
Well, I perhaps have part of the answer, because at that time, when the decision was being made, or before the decision was made, Mr. Pombrio, the principal, called me one day, and he said, because I do plastering and stuff, he wanted to know if I would come in and look in the Cicero room. And it just happens that Bob brought out some pictures, and this is the first one there. And in this end, you'll see those two indentations where the statues are.
Yeah?
Well, every year when I sat in that room in high school, the paint and plaster was always peeling off from there. And he called me up to see if I would go and look at it. So I went and took a look at it, and it wasn't a big amount of work. So after supper, that was going to be in a couple of Saturdays. So I went in with my equipment and just a scaffold or stepladder, and I started to scrape off the paint. Well, I was scraping it off. Well, I was scraping through the plaster. It wasn't difficult with my trowel. Plaster was coming out, and the next thing, I'm getting to rusty wire lath coming out. So I get nearer my work as far as I could reach. If you look at that, I don't know if Calvin can get a good picture of it, but I was reaching as far as I could reach with my brick hammer, and now I'm into the terracotta block that the center of this wall is made of. Back then, it was a terracotta block, unglazed clay block. And it was laid with holes through it vertically. And they were completely, they just crumbled. So the answer was there was moisture. So, of course, I brought Mr. Pombrio in, and he looks, and what had caused it was leaks in the roof. Where the roof comes down, you have the gutter and takes the water down through the spouts, which are enclosed in the building. So the exterior of that school was stuccoed onto the exterior of these block, and the interior was plaster. These block are made so you can plaster or stucco on. They were a great building product. We don't use it anymore because block came in. But those things were completely deteriorated. The water had come down so many years unnoticed, because don't forget these blocks are hollow. This is on the third floor. And it took, if you had that condition up there, what did you have down where the water was pooling,
right,
with no drain? From there, the decisions were made by the board.
Yeah.
And of course, there were two referendums whether to tear it down or build, and they both supported removing the school. And there's a lot of heartache, because the general feeling in this area, I grew up with it, anything Mr. Minor built was there forever.
Right.
It's understandable. You know, a lot of people felt very badly, but the decision had to be made. And I don't know the rest of the story. I, also talking about the wiring and the electrical system needed an update. Somebody.
But no money coming in because the state.
That's right.
The state wouldn't support it.
And going back to watch the DVD that came out, Chicago wasn't making the money at that particular time. If mm-hmm. the facts are there. So there was no money coming from there. And if you remember, over the years prior to building the school, the exterior had been repainted several times. I remember one time with a kind of a rubberized paint that was supposed to bond. Well, it eventually lifted up. And the stucco on the outside showed a lot of exterior cracking. Not that it was going to fall off,
mm-hmm.
but they were painting it to keep moisture from coming in at that time. From the exterior. I don't know what to say.
Hmm.
Decision was made.
And what was your feelings, Bob?
Well, we were sorry to see it go, but with what I was told with the financial part of it, it seemed like that would be the way to go, so to tear it down or build a new one, new school. I know it was a very hard decision, and there were a lot of folks that could get the time when they tore the old school down that just watched it from start to finish,
mm-hmm.
watched the whole process. And the people that were there never stopped talking about what a shame it was to see the building go. It was one of a kind building. Especially in this area,
mm-hmm.
and if it were still here and the money was available to keep it repaired, it would be a showplace.
Sure.
Something very unique.
So it was almost like you didn't want to let it go, but it just financially it made sense that you had to do
that's
it.
That's right.
It would be very expensive to maintain in the situation, condition mm-hmm. it was in.
Yeah,
you've got to look at the realities. Emotions were there. Still are.
They still are.
Are among the offspring of we old timers.
Sure.
Sure.
Yeah. Well, just wanted to get your feelings because you guys went through that school and wanted to get your thoughts on the school that you so beloved was now the building. I mean, the school is the people and the teachers and stuff like that. That's a building, but the building came down and we have our new school. We call it new. It was new in 69. But so we're celebrating 100 years, and you got some neat pictures to go through. And you wanted to go through the yearbook too, right, Calvin?
Yeah, so we'll take a break right here.
Okay. And while we're on break, Calvin brought up a very good point. We assume everybody knows about Minor and what he did for the area, and then, of course, Reverend Mott with the school. But William H. Minor did more than just build the school for Chazy. He also had Heart's Delight Farm. He did the Physicians Hospital in Plattsburgh. Now, is it your grandfather that was the head?
It's my grandfather, Uncle John's father.
Your father, okay.
The master carpenter.
Right.
At the
school.
School.
Now, did he do anything at the Heart's Delight Farm?
Yeah, those were his projects.
So that he was like the overall...
I think he was with Mr. Minor almost 30 years.
Okay.
So going back to beginning, I assume he was involved in all that stuff because...
Now, do you think he was involved with the Physicians Hospital too?
No, I often ask. No, that was another... He had... No.
Okay.
As far as I know, a name that he referred to many times... At the physician, the fellow who had whether he ran the whole thing was a guy by the name of Mr. Edward St. Denis, who lived in West Chazy. Now, Dad was museum, the farm, the school.
Okay.
Yeah, he had his office in Gray Gables.
On the Gray Gables building?
Yeah,
okay.
Downstairs.
Yeah.
Was my father's office. And
okay.
What is Gray Gables?
Calvin says, what is Gray Gables?
Well, Gray Gables is right next to us here.
And what was that building originally?
It was built by Mr. Minor to house the teachers. At that time, most of the teachers were unmarried ladies. And he decided to give them an adequate home place where they can live and eat. And sometimes during the process, I think the annex was built for more with apartments for married teachers. Mm-hmm. But looking at something I saw recently in Great Gables, there are apartments in the upper floors for married teachers. Yes.
Okay.
But that was there. And
now that there's a story that there was a tunnel from Gray Gables to the school.
Right under the sidewalk where the heat went down through. And under the sidewalk that connected Gray Gables across Route 9 into the school. Had lights on in several areas along the sidewalk were these heavy metal covers so the custodians and people could get down there. And of course, it wasn't uncommon for us, the boys, to lift up and see what was down there.
Now, was it used as a walkway from Gray Gables to the
school? It was not
school?
A walkway.
It
you
was
could not
okay.
walk through at all.
Okay.
No, it was 3.5. You had to squat through.
Okay.
To go through. No, it was not a walk.
Yeah, the rumor I heard that it was a walk through for the teachers for
no,
the bad
never,
weather to
never,
get to the school.
Never. Impossible.
Okay.
Because I know I've crawled down there.
Okay.
Official purposes only.
That's right. That's
and
right.
Wait, if you dared, you'd walk as close to Green Gables.
Of course, you never went in there as a high school kid. We understand that. It was strictly to do some work and stuff.
Not really.
Pleading the fifth. So, Bob, I see you brought out a book on the Physicians Hospital.
Yeah, that's more or less a similar book to the yearbook of the school that was
okay.
put out. But it shows the rooms and more or less what went on there. That was a state-of-the-art hospital at the time it was opened. And the main part of it is still there inside the buildings of the new hospital.
Now, was this book published the year this was built? Because I see it's 1929.
Well, I'm not sure of when it was published. It could be that it was put out in 1929 because it says there.
Right.
The hospital was completed by 1929. I think the years that come to my mind of here to talk was either 24 or 1926. It was all completed. Yeah.
Do you know how long it took to complete the school?
No, I do not.
Okay, so the hospital came after the school.
After the school.
So if I understand this right, it was Heart's Delight Farm first, school second, Physicians Hospital third?
Yes, you're right.
$1 million dam second.
And,
$1 million dam.
That's something that right. Dan talked about, this miners' hydroelectric projects. The first one was at Lake Alice. There were 7 dams built up there with 1 generating facility, and that was going along good until the need for electricity outgrew what that could put out. So he came down into the village and rebuilt the 2 dams here in the village and a powerhouse that was named Hillbrook. And then from there, when that was kind of overrun, he went to Suckertown, which is 1.5 miles downriver, and bought all the property around there, tore all the buildings down, built a new dam with a 2 turbine generating plant, and that lasted for a while. And when he outgrew that and everything behind it, he moved up to build a $1 million dam. Now that $1 million dam was quite a project. It involved a lot of acreage of being cleared, and the dam, what was it, 2,700 feet long?
Yeah, that was my dad's project.
Yeah. That was one of your father's projects.
Yeah. And they finally filled it with water. The Little Chazy River wasn't really good enough flow of water to take care of it. But the worst problem up there was there was a glacial dumping of small rocks that were porous, and the water would seep out. They couldn't hold the water in. It was just a losing sort of a situation. So they tried for 7 years, and it didn't work, so he abandoned it. Went to Altona, up west of Altona, on the Great Chazy River, and built the McGregor Dam and the McGregor Powerhouse, which is still visible from the Devil's Den Road up
right,
there.
Yeah.
And right in front of the McGregor Powerhouse, he built the LaSalle Dam and used 6 foot penstock to take the water down to the LaSalle Powerhouse, which never really did too much. They used the McGregor Powerhouse to generate power for a good many years, and that took care of the farm, the school, the street lights here in town. And that's another plus that we had. Mr. Miner supplied all the street lights and the maintenance on them and paid for the electricity himself. And I guess the McGregor Dam Powerhouse supplied the hospital with power too. Am I right on that? You don't know. Well, it seems to me it did. And in later years, they started converting to NYSEG. So power was taken away from his production. I think it was in the '60s that they converted and start because they were still running the farm with the big generators at the powerhouse at the Institute up until the early 60s. And then they decided they'd go with NYSEG and converted everything to that. But those dates I haven't got
right
correct, I or for certain, because I'm not sure. I do remember when it all took place. And one thing I remember, the generators at the powerhouse were so big that they couldn't run them with any force at all. They had to just let them idle, and they'd make soot. One time we had a fire call, one of the big mufflers was burning inside. The soot caught fire, and it caused a very smoky situation. And after that, they decided that they would, Clifford Fredericks, the engineer up there, built a system of water spray inside the muffler to clean the mufflers while they were running, so that that wouldn't happen again. But the I remember we had I was on that fire call, and we had quite a time up there with that smoke.
I imagine.
Yeah. And they used to run, after that they'd run one generator and then they'd go to another. They'd switch off, and so that one generator would have to work harder. They said that if you ran them both, you'd have enough power generated to take care of the town of Chazy at that time. Whether that was true or not, I don't know. But it was after, in the 60s, that they shut those generators down, and that was the end of the Miner power.
Wow. What were you going to say there, Uncle Johnny?
See, I do remember that.
You do remember that?
You could remember generating enough power, yeah.
So the yearbook. Okay, you guys, Uncle Johnny, you got pictures here. Actually, these are from the yearbook, I think.
Well, yeah, those are the original pictures that went in that yearbook.
Okay, that were in. Do you want to go by the yearbook, Calvin, or do you want to go by these pictures here?
You can go any way you want, really.
Well, yeah, I'll do whatever you guys want me to do.
I think the pictures.
Look at these, and then we go through the yearbook. You've already seen them.
Okay.
Seen.
All right. Yeah. So let's start with these first.
Well, that is an error.
Just hold it toward Calvin. You can talk about that.
That one there, I believe, is ventilation sort of an arrangement. It looks like there's radiators that maybe the air could be blown through and heat blown through them. I'm not sure what I'm talking about, really. Yeah.
If you guys want to pipe in.
Yeah.
I can't help you there. You're talking there. The guy we need here now is Armin Dupree.
Yeah. That's the only
on that stuff, because he lived it.
Actually, we'll go with these pictures here, because this is doing, or has to deal with the heating system.
Okay, this is the Cicero room. The language room, more or less.
French and Latin.
French and Latin.
French and Latin. They had...
It was all white, pure white. They had a board that would push up. You could see the blackboard, and then when they weren't using it, they'd pull it down and make a completely white wall. On one end, the west end, you had two statues. The other day I saw the names of who the statues were of, and on the other end of the room, there was columns like Roman edifice sort of a thing. But we remember that room quite well.
Yes, we do.
So what do you remember best about that room?
Well... It was nothing bad, but that was okay. It gave me a Christmas vacation in there.
Yeah, and you remember that room well, Uncle Johnny?
Oh, yes, I do. I remember the last teacher we had was Miss Weatherup, who stayed on quite a few years, as I understand.
We had the same teacher, Miss Weatherup, Elma.
Yep. Yeah. Could you speak some Latin for us?
No, that and typing is both. I never did real well in either one.
What do you got here, Bob?
Well, this is the agricultural classroom. That was down on the very first floor, on the south end of the school. And Dick and I never had any classes in there. The room, I guess, was closed when we were there.
Wasn't used for anything at that time.
I remember going by and seeing the statue of the bull standing there, and the desk and everything that were in the room. But that turned out a lot of good information for young farmers to work on when they got...
Well, I noticed in this picture, was it in the early years did you wear uniforms to go to Chazy?
We didn't.
No. Do you remember that, Uncle Johnny?
We did not. That room was closed, but it had closed before I got
before
there.
They stopped
teaching the agricultural course.
Okay. So I'm just wondering, in the early years of the school coming in, because all the guys are wearing, it looks like, suits.
Yeah.
Oh, they did. If you look at all those pictures, they all wore suits.
Was that just the common attire to go to school?
You did. You had to. Yeah. And on Fridays,
you really had to have your suit and tie on.
Friday was suit and tie day?
Yeah.
It was a dress-up day.
Dress-up day, yeah.
Okay. Must have been a Friday picture.
The opposite of a casual
Friday. Yeah. Times have changed.
Now, this is just one of the regular classrooms with students.
Have no idea where in the school that
no,
one was.
No, that
okay.
one there, I don't know. It would, it would be up the second or third floor. And I'm just trying to figure which end of the school it would be on, but I can't tell.
That'd probably be on the north
end. North end, yeah, with the door over
the
on
over
this
there
side.
And the windows.
Yeah.
And every room had a teacher's bathroom in it.
Yeah.
Everyone. It was a private bath, restroom for the teacher.
Well, that was the door right here. That was the teacher's restroom right there.
Okay.
This is the door in and out.
Okay.
So, there were no children using their facilities. Every classroom had a clock, like that clock up there.
Okay.
That was the classroom clock.
So they didn't have digital clocks back then?
Well, we weren't sure how to tell time with a digital clock at that time.
We hadn't learned to read yet.
Now, I can imagine those teachers, the older teachers, when the new school was built, here they are used to having a bathroom in their room, and all of a sudden, that must have been a shock for them.
I know in the elementary, there are bathrooms, I'm pretty sure, in the new school for the
for kindergarten.
Elementary teachers, that whole wing, I think there's a bathroom.
Well, in the hallway.
Well,
no. But you're talking in the classroom?
In the classroom. The elementary, the one classroom I work in, there's a restroom on one end for the boys and one on the other end that the teachers all come into that room when they have to use the restroom.
Oh.
And usually the doors on those restrooms are from both classrooms so that this first graders can use the bathroom, the boys on that end, and if the second graders are up on the next room, they use the bathroom from the other side. It's the same room, but they can get to it
right
easily. But I don't know any more than that. So this is a picture of the shop. Now, from what I can make of the pictures of the school, that shop originally was it was a tar paper shack when we were there, more or less, it was a good structurally sound building, built with studs and boarding on the outside but covered with tar paper and never insulated or finished off. This is a picture of just how it looked when we worked there. You could see right out to the outer wall.
You worked there through the winter months.
Oh, yes.
They had good heat in there. They had radiators.
Oh, yeah. They had radiators.
So it was heated in there.
Oh, yes, it was.
Okay.
Of course, and the boiler room was across the driveway, but there was plenty of power coming out of that boiler room to heat that. There maybe one or two days it was a little chilly, but for the most part, it was very comfortable.
20 below day or something like that. That was one time I remember we couldn't go. We returned back.
So you, all of you, had classes in that room right there?
Oh, yes. Yeah.
Okay.
Yep. Now, this building originally was, there's pictures when they built the school of the pictures that we have. There were two buildings built for the carpenters and other men that were working on the school to have a place to work, and that was one of them. And they just converted it to a classroom after the school was built. There was another one up on the southwest corner of the school that had a steam engine in it. It was blowing a lot of steam in one of the pictures. So,
well, I know Calvin pointed out in this picture, Calvin, these young men had ties.
Well, you notice that tie, some of them were tucked.
Yeah,
you're supposed to tuck the tie because there were cases where that got caught in the lathe.
I bet. Yeah.
Yeah, that would give you quite a shot.
Get your attention.
Your tongue would kind of hang out when that wound up to the end. Now, this is a business office. It shows the, I got two pictures there. Now, the secretary working. Oh, now we're back to the mechanicals. Those are water storage tanks somewhere down in the lower part of the school, of the building. And then, of course, they used to use the north entrance for the buses when the school was first built. Later on, they used the south entrance and made a parking lot down on that side of the school. And we used to go in the annex entrance. The annex was built in 1923. So maybe that's when they changed the parking lot around. This, okay, here we are, our famous lunchroom. This would be the elementary lunchroom, it looks like. They had the marble top tables.
Oh, was that up on the fifth floor?
Yeah.
Right over the gyms.
And it shows the lady coming down with her rolling shelf loaded with soup bowls. That was back when they had the cafeteria running, and they had that famous soup that you used to
every day of the week. It was bean soup.
So famous, a good famous?
It was
famous?
Good.
It was good?
It was hearty. It was good.
Now, five stories up, I'm assuming there were elevators in the school.
We'll show a picture of that later on.
You'd walk it up?
We walked up. There was an elevator that went to that.
The lower grades.
That elevator went from the basement of the school. Well, I think the highest it went was up, say, that fifth floor.
Okay.
But once, and we would get off on the back of the elevator as we're facing it, go to the right to the elementary, or it would go to the left to the high school. But in the upper grades, we walked up the five floors to it. But the elementary, they put them in the elevator and take them.
Interesting.
Just another shot of the school shop. This man here is Warren Dupree when he was in school. I don't know who the other one was. Maybe you can tell me.
Well, I think that's the same year as, I think that's the year that my brother Lawrence graduated. I think they had to be 26 because I think they were in the same class. Yeah.
Again, I'm amazed they're working on this machinery dressed up and wearing a tie.
You see. Yeah. You see the tie's tucked in. It's all about this guy. I guess he.
So they, but they still got their projects built. Now, this one here is of the school doctor's office, and this person sitting right here is John's brother, Monroe, who is Dick's father.
That's Monroe right
there?
That's
Monroe, the one with the brace on.
Yeah. Right here. Okay.
And there's more to go with that brace, too, but I can tell you about it later on. But that's Monroe. Well, he had to be, I don't know, maybe was either 12 years old or something.
It looked something like that.
Yeah, he was born in 1907, so he'd be 12, 13 years old.
You know, they all look scared going to the doctor's office there.
Yeah.
You don't want to talk now?
You want to talk about the brace?
Well, the injury to his leg. Now, see, my grandfather, Uncle John's father, worked for Miner, and Pa got infection in his leg. They used to live up near Lake Alice, and there was a big pond out there, and they were playing. Anyway, he cut his leg somewhere or other. And he ended up in the hospital, and at that time, the hospital was on the corner of Broad and Williams. It's a white building. I think it's called Kimball Apartments now. And anyway, Pa ended up in that hospital. And Dr. Cassius Silver, he ended up being one of Miner's friends, did the surgery. And what they did, they went into my father's leg and cut out all the deteriorated portion of the bone and went into his arm and took a bone chip. And this is maybe, 1907, we'll say 10 years, 1917, before the physician's hospital was built. And anyway, he took that bone chip out of his arm and grafted it to where he had removed that deteriorated portion in his leg. And the story Pa used to tell occasionally, the doctors wanted to amputate that leg, but my grandfather wouldn't allow it. So back at that time, Dr. Silver took that chip, grafted it to that bone, and Pa lived to be 87 years old.
Right.
He always had a distinct limp because the leg didn't develop quite as good as the other one. And at that time, like I say, my grandfather was working for Miner. This is another credit to Mr. Miner. Miner paid for all the hospitalization of my father's stay, and he had many surgeries over a period of half a dozen years. And there's a newspaper article which I've got. Miner was so impressed with the success of that surgery. Again, you got to think it's 100 odd years, almost 100 years ago, for that graft to take, and the man lived to be 87. But anyway, Miner was so impressed with that surgery, and he, at that time, he'd become friends with this Dr. Silver. That's one of the reasons that Miner built that physician's hospital in Plattsburgh, was because of the success of that surgery and old Dr. Silver.
Wow, that's amazing.
Am I correct on that?
Yes. Well, as far as I know, you are, because, again, I was just a little fellow, and I don't remember all the detail. But I do remember, this is kind of a, Mr. Miner used to write out orders and stuff, and you may or may not know this, but my father, in the position he was in, had a lot of papers and stuff and tools, and they all ended up with me after he died. And after the war, I had these boxes, and I remember going into one of these big boxes, finding these red, yellow, or yellow, pink, and white slips. And in this was where Mr. Miner had sent a note to my dad, and I foolishly didn't keep it, saying that he had become aware of his son, I think his word. And from that point on, Monroe was supposed to be sent to the hospital to be taken care of, Mr. Miner's doctors. Words like that. You know, it was handwritten. And that's the way notes to my father to do this or that. It was three copies and whatever color went to him.
Right.
But that's the way things were done there. In a pecking order, you had Mr. Miner, Mr. Hamilton, and my dad. That was the way it went.
That's the way it went down?
You know, as far as the construction was
concerned. Right, right.
And then in the other departments, you had these other various, you know, the electrician and
sure. The
agricultural people, which Kevin said that's a whole other story about the farm.
Mm-hmm. We're back to the school buses.
Okay, well, this is just another picture of the north entrance when the school buses and students were out there. You can see that there's motor-driven buses and horse-drawn buses all ready to go. They get loaded on there.
You can see those pictures of those houses in the back, the one on the corner, and yeah. The one in the center is gone now, but old Ralph McEwen lived in the one on the corner.
Right there.
Then there was a family of Larmy, then another people bought it, then that's the one, well, I don't know, Bob Lapierre bought that, the third one over.
Yeah.
They're still there today.
Right.
But the center one is gone.
I'm just thinking, there was room for another house between Lapierre's and the...
That's where the Goodsells lived at one time, I'm pretty sure. The house.
Of course, he's got his...
Goodsell lived in Bob Lapierre's house, yeah.
Okay.
But yes, they shared the same driveway, that house in the center, and okay, again, that
right,
big
okay.
white house where they shared the same driveway.
Shared driveway, okay.
And here's the boys' gym.
Yeah, I heard it was a small gym.
Yeah, it was. It was too small to have basketball games because there was no room for spectators anywhere.
So where would you play your games?
In the church hall.
The church hall.
Really?
Well, see, that church hall used to be longer and higher than it is now. There's a what you call a drop ceiling.
Right.
In there now. Well, there's about 8 feet above there. That's, you get that ceiling out of there, about 8 feet above, and when you go into the church hall, you used to come in maybe about 12 feet, and the basketball court run way down to there. Because when you went into the church hall from the street immediately to the left, which was a room, maybe we'll say it come out 10 or 12 feet, was a little concession stand. Then to the right as you come in, well, there's a classroom there now.
Right.
But that came out, say, 10 or 12 feet, and it was a coat room. And the basketball court came right down.
To that point.
To that point. So it was 12, 20, 25 feet longer.
But where were the spectators watching?
There was just chairs set up around the edge. About 3 feet in, there was a line. And there were just individual chairs that they would sit around the end. And the scoreboard was up on the stage. It was just maybe 4 or 5 foot square. And what it was a couple old bottoms out of a 55-gallon drum that they had the numbers painted on
right.
For the home team and the visiting team. And there'd be a score where they'd turn one of those things and, you know, to, as the score went up.
Oh, my.
And that's where, and there wasn't a school team as such. It was town teams.
Okay.
The school, I don't know, having a basketball team that traveled. When I was a senior, maybe a few years before that, they had a baseball team that traveled. But I don't remember, but it was a town team mostly.
Okay.
In the 60s, Chazy would play their home games at Champlain Central School in Champlain.
Oh, yeah?
Yeah. Back when your brother Bruce was in school,
Bruce,
and so on.
Bobby, yeah.
Yeah.
Hmm.
Yeah. So you want to take a break here?
Sure. And as we come back, we're looking at the route when Chazy centralized all these dots here were small, one classroom schools at the time?
One room schools.
One room schools. And you have 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10, 11. 11
districts.
11 districts formed one.
Mm-hmm.
I was noticing there was one out by Kings Bay.
Yep.
One out on Trombley's Bay. Then you had Rhett and Chazy Lane by Saxes. Was that where that school was?
Yeah. That was, that's district number one. And that was right across from where Jane Hess lives. Now,
yeah.
There's a clump of trees. You can still see the foundation, but that's where the school's at.
Now, Uncle Johnny, you're off camera. You're telling kind of a neat story that back then the school bus was actually a horse-drawn bus.
Yes.
Okay.
They had the three motorized ones, but the districts are pretty much horse-drawn.
Okay. So those horses did more than just bring the kids to school.
Yes.
So tell us a story about what would happen once the kids were dropped off.
Well, many of the Teamsters, of course, would either have to go home or stay there. And I know that many of them were employed by, at this time, my dad at the school to work on the construction of the new school. And when it was time to bring the kids home from school, again, they'd hitch up back to the buses. And
take the kids home.
Take the kids home. Of course, I guess being an old Studebaker guy, I want to say that those horse-drawn buses were all Studebaker made buses.
Now, one of the of course, as we move in time and now with social media and stuff, which was never heard of back when the school was first put up, they have a Facebook page for the 100-year class. Or the celebration of the 100 years. And of course, we have a picture of Lincoln here, President Lincoln. And when you walk into the school now, he's facing you as soon as you come in. The question that Steve Patino has been asking, where was President Lincoln at the old school?
Right as you come in that main entrance.
Miner was above it. Miner's picture above it.
Was it?
Yeah, when they brought Miner's picture.
But you come up that main entrance, And there was same statue.
So it was the main entrance, the second floor. You had the basement, second floor, which is like
second floor.
It was a second floor.
It would be on what we would call the second floor, right?
Okay.
Because the main entrance, you'd come up 6 or 8
stairs,
and
now this is from when you came in from the pond view.
No, from the front pond at that time.
The front.
That would be on the
west side
of the school. That's where the main entrance was.
The main entrance was still facing the current pond, right?
Yes.
Yes, okay.
Yes.
But farther back.
Yes, because
the school was built around the old
school. This school was built in front of the old school.
Right, okay.
So if you were to walk right, that entrance actually is about where the lobby, or a little bit beyond where the lobby of the school is now, was the main entrance.
Okay.
Because the driveway used to come up almost 100 feet to the west of where it does now.
Okay. So when you walked up the stairs, when you walked into the lobby, you saw President Lincoln.
That's where Lincoln was, yes.
So basically the same as you see now.
Same idea.
Okay.
Same idea, right at the main entrance.
And then above the statue was a portrait of Mr. Minor?
Yes.
Now, would that be the same portrait that's in the lobby now but off to the left when you walk
that
in?
That I couldn't say. I would just assume.
Okay.
So I really couldn't say.
All right, because that was one of the big questions that Steve Patino had on this statue, which obviously if you go into Chazy now is currently there.
That's where it was in the old school.
Okay.
Just as you come in.
And I know we're kind of going around here, but here's a neat picture, Calvin. This is the actual construction of the school, and you can see all the scaffolding around. But you'll notice above where the clock tower is. Now, were you saying, Bob, that Mr. Minor didn't like the height of the clock tower?
That tower that was there was like the ones up front. There were just a short tower. And the clock at that time was in a round spot over the main entrance. Now, when Mr. Minor saw that, he didn't care for that. He said, I want the clock where everybody can see it, and so that it would show in four directions. And that's when they changed and decided to put a clock tower up.
So now there's a sketch on here. I don't know if Calvin can get that on the camera, a hand sketch. Where'd that hand sketch come from?
It was in with all these pictures that we got.
Okay.
David K. Martin gave Tina Trombley, when she was a historian here, 7 boxes that he had rescued that were going to be thrown out from the old school. And he stored them in his basement for many years, and he decided they'd be better here. So he gave them to Tina, and she gave me the job of sorting them all out and categorizing them.
Okay.
Well, these pictures were all in those boxes, and that's where that came from. That had been over to the school for many years, and then in his place.
And the date on this was January 3rd, 17?
Probably, yes.
So the school was functioning in 16, but construction was still going on?
It was still under construction when classes started.
Okay.
Yes.
All right.
Yes.
So that was an afterthought, more or less. We have the picture of the clock in the front of the school. It's somewhere around here.
Okay.
And I might be able to run onto it quickly, but I'm not sure.
Okay.
But the it's not right here in these pictures.
And other than this picture here?
Other than that picture, yeah. That was after the clock tower was completed.
Now there's another thing you've given us here, and this was from Reverend Father Victor for the graduates. You don't see that around too often in this day and age, but it's a prayer for the graduates.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, I saw that and I said this would be something interesting too.
Yeah, that's kind of neat. And that class, 2, 4, 6, 8, 1921, were 9 graduates.
Mm-hmm.
You must remember Father Victor.
Oh, yeah, sure do, yeah.
We got some of the... Okay, we've got some more pictures here of the school. We've got a lot of them. Here's what the boiler room looked like.
Those were the big coal boilers. And I think it shows one man, yes, throwing some coal in.
Oh, yeah, right here. Yeah.
Right there, and
looks like he's throwing his leg in more.
Well, they amount of coal that went through there was astounding to me. The firemen had to shovel in several tons on a cold night when they'd fire all night. Of course,
so was that fed all night long?
Yeah.
Or is it you just feed it once and it would last through the night?
Oh,
no. No, they'd have to keep feeding it.
Yeah. It was all night. They had firemen. These fire these
around the clock.
That shift they worked. I think they worked a 12-hour shift. Those guys did. They worked 10 days.
So somebody worked in that school all night long in the winter months.
Yeah, I know. Like Frank Cody was a brother-in-law kid. That was what he was doing there. Yes.
Well, the school, those boilers not only heated the school, but they heated Gray Gables. And at one time, the museum and Presbyterian Church and the stone house is out near the sidewalk, this side of the Presbyterian Church.
And the minister's house, Reverend Kay's house was heated.
Over there. So that the boilers had to be kept going at a pretty good rate to pump that steam all the way over here across the road. It kept the road nice and clear for about 2 feet.
Yes.
I'm sure it did,
Yeah. And this is a picture of the boiler room. Or not the boiler room, but the switchboard. Mm-hmm. And that was on the opposite side of the center hallway from the boiler room.
Absolutely amazing.
And, oh yes, the boys' pool.
So the boys' pool and the girls' pool?
Girls' pool. Up above the pool was the gym on the next floor.
Okay.
The gymnasium was up there. But then underneath the gymnasiums, there was a pool on each side of the school. One for boys, one for girls. The boys' school had a male figure at the end of the pool that John Ray from Beekmantown, the sculptor, did for Mr. Miner. And on the girl's side, they had it was a nude figure is what it was, of a woman standing there at the end of the pool. I don't know.
I think those figures are still where the pool is now.
Yeah, they've still got those statues in the pool. They got them both, yeah. They got them both in this new pool. And there's the showers. They had the red tile button floor, more or less. Mm-hmm. And you go down in there and come out smelling like a rose. And here's one of the sand tables that was used in the classes, like Dick was put behind one. he disobeyed.
Is that bringing bad memories back, you what, looking at this picture right now?
I forget.
No comment.
No. So those are the sand tables that you're talking about.
Yeah. Yeah, they were in just the first grade.
So they just had to go sit by the sand table?
Sit behind it.
Oh, sit by the sand table.
And here's a couple of pictures of the library. That's probably more picture than we want. But there's the library.
Now, from this picture, I mean, of course, it looks like it was rather small.
It wasn't that large, was it?
Well, there were several rooms. You went into the main room where the librarian sat, and then you had other, at least one, maybe two.
There was a room in the back of that.
You go right through this double door to the next room. And that, the farther you got in there, the higher the grade was that would be going in there.
Yeah, yes. That was right down on the ground floor, the yeah. basement floor.
The first door you'd go in, the yeah. main part of it was the elementary side, and then the high school or upperclassmen would just go through the door to the next room and get what they would need. And, oh yes, this is just another classroom here, but there's our auditorium doors. There were three of those along the
leather doors?
Yeah, leather doors.
Thick leather. You could tell you touched it.
A little brass
it wasn't
buttons.
Fake.
Yeah, they were nailed. Mm-hmm. Those
tacks.
Upholstery. Yeah.
What are those, like frosted windows?
Yes.
Well, they painted them on the inside.
Okay.
That way you couldn't see through them.
Now, do you have pictures of the auditorium?
Yes.
The yearbook has
There's
them.
Some okay. in the yearbook. We're getting down to the end of the pictures I've got on this. This is the first graduating class that went through 4 years in the new building of high school. That was 19...
Seven people.
Yeah. This one right here is Maynard Lapeer. Bob Lapeer, the pharmacist.
Yeah, his father.
Yeah.
That was taken in 1920.
20, yeah.
That picture.
Right, okay, yeah. And that's the front entrance of the school?
Yeah.
Yes. I know it's... Yeah. A lot of kids who went to the school at that time, because it was a high school, who came from out of town. Now this Jeanette, they lived on the road, I guess the Fisk Road, almost into the corner where the restaurant is, on the right mm-hmm. in front of the city. There. And I was thinking about coming here and how... Also at that same time, from Altona, Ralph Palmer lived in Scioto, I think, then. His dad did. But from Altona came several families, Averills and Stark, from all with horse and buggy, horse and sleigh in the winter. Now, they came to school every day. And you're thinking of the effort from the parents to get these kids into a high school.
Mm-hmm.
So Halsey Stark?
Yeah, he was our county clerk.
Right.
Can you remember that?
Well, sure.
He's on the board.
Halsey Stark?
Yeah.
And then the Stark store in Altona, right in the corner. But
get him.
I think of that often coming, the cold days. Must have been some provision that shed this school or something for him, maybe mm-hmm. back. But this Jeanette from West Chazy, and there's probably a lot of others that I don't know about.
Mm-hmm. What do you got there, Bob?
We got the boardroom in the old school. And the table and chairs are in the boardroom of the new school.
Very familiar with them.
Yeah. That's the desk at the end was the principal's desk. That's where Mrs. Inglis, when I came to Chazy in the spring of 1944, Mrs. Inglis took me in there and sat me in a chair facing her and grilled me on second grade questions to make sure that I was smart enough to go to second grade.
Really?
Yeah, and I faked it pretty well. I made it.
You made it. You made
yeah.
it great.
So.
Could you still pass?
I'm not sure. I'm not sure. I work with once a week first graders and third graders, and I enjoy the third graders because they teach me so much over there. So I don't know if I could make it today with the way things are going. But that's that one. And just one quick picture, a couple quick pictures of Gray Gables. This is when the dormers were put in up on the top to make it a third three-story building. And you can still, on this picture, see that it's a brick building. It was, that building was built in 1872, I think. It was the district number two school for Chazy. And there was 128 students
146
there?
146, says here.
146? I know there were quite a few of them. And they had 9 grades in that school. There were bottom floor was divided into a room on each end, and the top floor was an auditorium, more or less, with a stage where they would have school programs plus meetings of the town. 1896, I believe, they had a town doings there that a lot of people came in with things that they wrote about the early part of the 1800s so that it wouldn't be forgotten. And there was a book. We have a copy of the book that was written with all those.
As you're talking about this, I'm assuming back then that Mr. Minor, did he have to go through the state of New York to get permission to do this? I would assume.
At least educational law.
But I mean, because he's the one that funded all this, so... You know, the state had to give a private citizen the okay to do this.
There was quite a bit done with the state. And he passed everything and was able to build a school. But it worked out quite well, apparently.
Now, in your study through all this, do you know how long it took from the time that he wanted to do this to actually become a reality? Was it like 10 years in the work? Was it 5 years in the work?
No,
have you guys ever heard anything about that?
I have, I don't know. I want maybe the movie that was produced a few years ago might tell that.
Okay.
But I don't, I haven't run on to any dates of that.
Okay.
Now this, as I was saying, there was 9 classes in this school up until 1909. Then they divided the upstairs and made 11 grades in the school. To get the total high school, or the total 12 years, the students had to go to Plattsburgh to get their end of their learning for the 12 years. If they had to have a regents, they had to go to Plattsburgh to take the regents. Now that meant getting on the train at 7 o'clock in the morning or 6 o'clock in the morning and getting back off at 7 at night. So many of the students back then, the girls would go find a family that needed help or wanted help, and they'd do housework, take care of the kids and for their room and board to be able to be in Plattsburgh to go to school. The boys would go down, they'd take care of the horses and do the work around the barns. Yeah, the barns to keep things, earn their keep to go to school. And that way they wouldn't have to travel so long. But this is what is the front part of Gray Gables, was the old district number two school. And then Mr. Minor built on in the back. And as John said, there were apartments right in the back that would handle married men teachers and their families. I remember because I used to go up and visit Bob Rathbun's place
sure.
up there.
Well, Bentley and
DeSello,
I don't think name. I remember when they all came shortly after the war, within 3 or 4 years after, and we got a group of young men teachers here, and it probably George Brindley came about that time. He wasn't the first.
He was in the 60s.
He was in the 60s. Okay.
Yeah.
Okay.
But we had Walt Hunsinger, Bernard Riley, Bob Rathbun, and then prior to that, there was Mr. Rusak.
Rusak was here. Rusak came in my day.
Yeah.
He came. There was a period of time then that you didn't have boy and girl gym teachers. That was probably when, it was during the Depression when things hit hard. And Rusek came, and of course I think there's spinoffs of Rusek, I think it's had a son or two that stayed Champlain or somewhere. Yeah. He was, but he did both boys and girls. In my day, we didn't have a female for the guys, but we had Rusek, and remember we had another guy for a year or two.
So, and we'll call this first, we'll end this shortly, but going back to Gray Gables, okay, just in my mind as you were talking, they were having classes there, okay?
That's right.
So we had one-room schools around. Mm-hmm. Minor built this first?
No.
No, he didn't,
he didn't build it.
He didn't build that.
This was built in 1871, I believe, at a cost of $7,000 to the school district.
So while he was trying to get the school built, he was moving kids over into here?
No. They moved from this school over to the, when they opened the new school, they okay. just went over there.
They just went over there, okay.
Yeah. This was the original school for the village.
So how did the one-room schools play into this?
Well, you had all these one-room school districts around.
Right.
As was a normal thing. And what he wanted to do was to build one school that everybody could be
right.
brought into.
But how does this fit into the...
Well, you assume that this went right into the system when the
So was it all one-room schools, and they ended up
and this
here and then over here?
Yeah, this was built a little bigger because there was a higher concentrate of residents in this area.
So were there kids in this school plus the one-room
yes,
schools?
Yes,
correct. Oh, okay. I thought there was an evolution from one-room schools to this
no.
to over here.
No.
So this was like the big school at the time.
Yeah, that's right.
Okay, and then you had the one-room schools. Yeah. Okay.
The one-room schools usually went to eighth grade.
Okay.
And all those children to get, well, when they could come here after they got over the eighth grade to go farther, but
sure.
to get any farther in their schooling, they had to go to Plattsburgh, which
okay.
meant travel.
Right, okay. So, Calvin, how long have we been here?
Long enough.
Long enough, but just to touch on that, if I just grab the
yeah.
mic for a second. I know in Champlain, my father went to a one-room school, which is right adjacent to my house, was right adjacent to where I'm living now, where he grew up. And it became, that place actually got moved and was the home of Maggie Hebert, who ran the Shangri-La, and that home is still standing there on Honeymoor's Corners. But they would go to school at that one-room school till probably eighth grade. Then if they wanted to go to high school, they'd go into the town in a Champlain Academy, which burned in 1940. But Champlain Academy was on the corner of Prospect and Elm Street. So it's probably a similar situation here. Except maybe you didn't have as much of a high school that they did in Champlain.
No.
Well, we're going to call this the first edition, Calvin.
First of 10.
First of 10. we're going to meet next week, same time, same place for us. But this has been a very obviously interesting hour and a half, roughly, of Chazy, the school, and the graduates of Chazy Central Rural School, and we're going to get into it much deeper in our next program, but we hope you enjoyed this, and if you really enjoyed this show and you're compelled to make a donation to Hometown Cable, you can send a donation to 1477 Ridge Road, Champlain, New York, 12919. We're very fortunate that we have Calvin, who takes his time and goes around and does this, and this is going to be a hometown classic, there's no doubt about it, and he has many of these through the years, and it can only happen if viewers support it or businesses support it, so Calvin would appreciate it. We enjoy doing the shows, and I want to thank Mr. and Mr. Wes, I call him Uncle Richard and Uncle Johnny, and Bob for doing this segment, and we'll be back next